I'm again here because I regret that my friend is not here because of some technical problems. So greetings from Dr. Feng from Shijiazhuang, China. As a part of long-term strategy to understand effect of nanoparticles on various brain and spinal cord function, this study will show changes in neuropathic pain syndrome after intoxication with engineered nanoparticles from metals. As we all know here that any lesion or injury of peripheral nerves over the time course will influence the structure and function of the central nervous system. And obviously, the spinal cord is very close, so the changes will occur most dramatically in the spinal cord. We have published a paper in Pain in 2006 where peripheral nerve injury can produce nerve barrier leakage. So we wanted to study that whether this leakage can be influenced by intoxication of nanoparticles. Here I will show you the results largely from neural and astrocytic changes. There are several ways for environmental pollution having exposure to nanoparticle, gunpowder explosion, desert environment, motor vehicle exhaust, so you don't need to be in the battlefield to have this nanoparticle intoxication. It can occur anywhere. So here, in a standard model, we produce a spinal nerve lesion, and we know that this produces neuropathic pain, and then we intoxicate it with copper, silver, or aluminum nanoparticles. Studied GFAP, immunohistochemistry, and neuronal changes. Pain behavior was studied by colleague, and survival here 2 to 10 weeks after surgery. So long term. Here is albumin. Albumin positive cells means the leakage of albumin in the spinal cord, and 4 weeks, 8 weeks, and 10 weeks in different regions. This is T10, T12, and L5. The nerve lesion was done in L4 and L5. So those rostral and these caudal changes are there. I'm not showing here rostral changes. So you can see here that nerve lesion gradually increases albumin deposit, and it is much more in T10, T12, and L5. So it is increasing downwards, much more leakage to the spinal cord barrier. And here you can see the same thing, the trend is always increasing this 10 weeks, 8 weeks, and 4 weeks. So 10 weeks is the highest increase in number of albumin deposits. Astrocytic response is also following in different segments of different groups here, and the maximum increase occurs after 10 weeks. Neuronal changes can also be seen. It is gradually increasing over the time. And the pain withdrawal latency measured by pain specialist, and it is also decreasing over the time. It means animals are corrupt. So here is that GFAP in neuropathic pain in normal situations, and here after nanoparticles intoxication. In this situation, this is the copper treatment here. And here is 10 weeks, and this is silver treatment. You can see the difference. This is much more neurodegeneration than without nanoparticle. Then we try to modify this neuropathic pain-induced changes in the spinal cord structural changes using a drug called Cerebrolysin. This is a mixture of different neurotrophic factors. And it also works for neuronal survival, neuroprotection, neuronal plasticity, and neurogenesis. In the model of brain injury and hyperthermia, we have seen that this compound is quite effective in a dose of 2.5 milliliter per kilogram intravenously, or even 5 milliliter per kilogram intravenously. have given this drug 2.5 milliliter per kilogram daily for 1 week, or 5 milliliter per kilogram for 1 week too. 1 week after lesion, 2 week after lesion, and then we study for 10 weeks. Here you can see that this is cerebrolysin treatment. This is GFAP after cerebrolysin in low and high doses. Here is albumin leakage, low and high doses. High doses was much more effective as compared to the normal situation, no treatments were given. In case of nanoparticles, high dose was given, and you can still see the GFAP expression is quite high and moderate, and albumin leakage can be seen still. So the message is that when neuropathic pain syndrome or any traumatic injuries could be altered by nanoparticles, the drugs are not equally effective. We need to have different strategies to find out the optimal dose or time that can have the same effect in the group that are not receiving nanoparticles. This is the message of this study. And we can say that nanoparticles intoxication can increase pain-induced pathology, and there are different drug effects might be changed to have optimal neuroprotection, especially when nanoparticles are. This is Dr. Feng, and this picture was taken in Shijiazhuang. Thank you very much for your time and attention.
You say arthrogryosis is a cure at neuropathic pain, right? Increased astrocytes, arthrogryosis, right?
Yes.
How about perivascular astrocytes? Did you analyze perivascular astrocyte condition?
Astrocytes, and we use GFAP anyway, like myself. Yeah. We can see around the microvessels. And until unless we don't go to electron microscope, it is very difficult to see that which kind of astrocytes they are doing. So we have not done electron microscopy on these kinds. They are in the way.
Maybe in the way, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, we have one more question. Please.
I just would like to ask you about the mechanisms of cerebrolysin action, because you apply cross factors, neurotrophic factors intravenously. And how are they delivered to the site of injury, or do they act somehow indirectly?
Yeah, well, so your question is that how cerebrolysin can enter to the injury site or the brain?
Yes.
Yes. I can only tell you as supplied by the information from the company, cerebrolysin is quite readily penetrable at the blood-brain barrier because it is a mixture of different neurotrophic factors and also small peptide fragments. So from the company we believe that it is entering into the brain, and also when there is an injury or alteration in the barrier, it is likely that they are penetrating much more than the normal situation.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, a couple issues. I'd like to remind the speakers for both afternoon sessions to load your slides now. Also, individuals who have their post